and welcome to the 24th Annual National Health Equity Research Webcast. I'm Ronda Taylor Bullock, the co-founder and director of the nonprofit organization called WEARE. WEARE stands for Working to Extend Anti-Racist Education. I also have deep ties with today's host institution. I attended UNC for both my bachelor's and master's degrees. This winter, I will be graduating from the Policy Leadership and School Improvement doctoral program. I will be your moderator for today's live, interactive broadcast from the Joan Heckler Gillings Auditorium at the Gillings School of Global Public Health at the campus of the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Our theme is From Awareness to Action, Leveraging Resiliency in the Context of Toxic Stress and Adverse Childhood Experiences. On behalf of this year's broadcast organizers and sponsors, I would like to welcome our studio audience, as well as the many hundreds of you joining us online from across and outside the United States. Before I introduce our panelists, I would like to recognize several of the many organizations and individuals who have made today's broadcast possible. All will be acknowledged at the conclusion of this broadcast and on our website, but at this time, we extend a special thanks to our leading co-sponsors. The UNC Gillings School of Global Public Health, led by Dean Barbara Reimer. The University Office of Diversity and Inclusion, led by Dr. Rume Alexander. The UNC Center for Health Equity Research, led by Dr. Giselle Gorby-Smith. The UNC Office of the Vice Chancellor for Research, led by the Vice Chancellor, Terry Magnuson. In North Carolina Area Health Education Center, or AHEC, led by Kevin Fitzgerald. For more than 75 years, UNC School of Public Health has been committed to groundbreaking research, exceptional teaching, and dedicated service to people across North Carolina, in the United States, and around the world. This marks the 24th year of the school's sponsorship of this annual broadcast as we continue addressing issues within health disparities. It's my pleasure to now turn the floor over to Dean Barbara Reimer from UNC's Gillings School of Global Public Health and today's welcome.
Thank you, Rhonda. Your work shows that what is done in communities really can contribute to mitigating, if not eliminating, structural racism. And we're going to be talking today about the effect of systemic racism and as part of the larger issue of adverse childhood experiences. So it's really a pleasure to welcome you all to the 24th National Health Equity Research Broadcast. Between those at the Gillings School of Public Health and online, there are over 772 people today who are showing their commitment to equity. And I'm really pleased to welcome our colleague from ECU, Ronnie Bell. Ronnie, are you here? Thank you. We're really glad that you're here and hoping that the people there are doing better after the hurricane. This annual webcast draws scholars, teachers, community leaders, students, public health, and healthcare professionals, practitioners from across the country and beyond. Each year's programs, thanks to Vic, are archived and available for free at the National Health Equity Research webcast webpage. They're great treasures. Many people come together every year to plan this event, and I'd like to ask them, this year's planning group, to stand so that we can give you a hand and thank you for what you've done. Thank you. It takes a lot of work, and they really do it because it's their passion and they love it. We're also pleased to welcome students who are visiting from local universities for Experience Gillings Diversity Preview Day. Would you all stand? We want to welcome you. And I want you to feel free to just walk up to anybody here and ask them about public health, Gillings, the university. We'll all be really happy to talk with you, and we're happy that you're here and so grateful to Trinette Cooper for bringing you here. This year's topic, which Rhonda just described, is urgent and important. Who can forget the image of the crying toddler on the cover of Time magazine July 2nd? showing the brutal separation of immigrant families in the United States, or the image of children in cages. In the aftermath of Hurricane Florence, like Maria, Matthew, Floyd, and others, those hardest hit are those who started out with the least, many of whom are children. Even in disasters, our zip codes have a bearing on health and equity. Health and other inequities have been with us a long time, and on this campus, we've been grappling with the Confederate statue, Silent Sam, that was erected in 1913, really a relic of the Confederacy and the lost cause that was trying to reinstate the conditions that really led to social and health inequities and have a very long shadow. Such symbols have far-reaching impact on adults and children. And in his May 2017 speech to mark the removal of Confederate statues from New Orleans public places, Mayor Lambrew spoke of the young child who walks by a Confederate statue every day. "Can you," he asked, "look into that young girl's eyes and convince her that Robert E. Lee is there to encourage her? Do these monuments help her see a future with limitless potential?" We all know the answers to these questions. And limitless potential is one of the goals I think that we should be thinking about today. Health equity depends on other kinds of equity too: living wages, healthy food, safe, walkable neighborhoods, environments free of threats to the health of children, and more. And that's one reason why I think it's really important that health and school professionals walk together on behalf of students. Accumulated stress in childhood, we now know, is a form of trauma that can leave a long signature. So this afternoon, you'll hear from and interact with panelists who come with great knowledge and experience: Kanwarpal Dhaliwal, LeRoy. Thank you. I'm sorry. And Krista Perreira and our moderator, Ronda Taylor Bullock. They will extend the ACEs pyramid by looking at it through a health equity lens. I believe that we're at a crossroad in this country. One fork in the road is where we are today, turning our backs on children, underfunding public schools, separating parents and children, allowing maltreatment, and limiting access to education and health care. There's another fork where I think people in this room and online, our virtual audience, would want to be: the one where every child gets a fair chance to achieve their potential. That's the America I love, and I think it's the America we can be. So I want to just read a short excerpt from a Langston Hughes poem that I think really is so relevant today. "Oh, let America be America again, the land that never has been yet and yet must be, the land where every man is free. Sure, call me any ugly name you choose, the steel of freedom does not stain. From those who live like leeches on the people's lives, we must take back our land again. Oh yes, I say it plain, America never was America to me, and yet I swear this oath, America will be." I think we should all remember that. It's hard to believe he wrote it so long ago, and it's still so relevant. All of us here today, I hope, will take our participation one step further and use our votes, our voices, our advocacy, and activism for positive change. It's never been more important for children and families. You're making a difference by being here and by being part of this effort today, and I want to thank you all for participating. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean Reimer.
Thank you.
And now it's time to introduce our panelists. Please hold your applause until I have introduced all three. Our first presenter is Kanwarpal Dhaliwal. Kanwarpal is one of the co-founders of RYSE and currently serves as its associate director. In her role, she supports and guides the implementation and integration of healing-centered practices grounded in racial justice and liberation across all of RYSE's program areas. She also develops, promotes, and advocates for policies, investments, practices, and research that enliven healing, justice, and liberation across the fields and sectors in which RYSE works. Kanwarpal believes that the purpose of her work and life is to contribute to movements, communities, and legacies of liberation that honor the ancestors who fought for her existence and survival, and to forge a world that is just and gentle for future generations. Before joining RYSE, Kanwarpal received a Master of Public Health and now serves as adjunct faculty at San Francisco State University. Our second presenter is Dr. LeRoy E. Reese. Dr. Reese serves as the principal investigator and director of the Smart and Secure Children's Parent Leadership Program within the Kennedy Satcher Center for Mental Health Equity. He co-directs the Pediatric Clinical and Translational Research Corps within MSM's Clinical Research Center. He conducts community-based health research focused on the promotion of positive physical and behavioral health, reducing risk by promoting resilience in the face of adverse environmental conditions, and the modification of community-based social determinants of health. Dr. Reese is involved in the translation of basic biomedical research findings into clinic and community-based settings. He was a member of the task force of the American Psychological Association that produced the report, Resilience and Strength in African-American Children and Adolescents. Dr. Reese also co-edited a commonly referenced prevention text entitled Realizing Social Justice, The Challenge of Preventative Interventions. Our third and final presenter is Dr. Krista Perreira. Dr. Perreira's research focuses on the relationships among family, migration, and social policy with an emphasis on improving health equity and eliminating racial, gender, and socioeconomic disparities in health. Integrating economic, psychological, and sociological theory, her research is highly interdisciplinary, involving collaborations with scholars in public health, medicine, nursing, psychology, sociology, and other disciplines. Her research also emphasizes partnerships with community-based organizations, schools, and local and state government committees in North Carolina. As a result, she has served as an advisory committee member or on the board of directors for several task forces and nonprofit organizations seeking to improve the provision of services to Latino populations, immigrants, and refugees in North Carolina. Most recently, Dr. Perreira, together with scholars from Chicago, Miami, New York, and San Diego, has received funding from the National Institutes of Health, NIH, to examine the cardiovascular health of Hispanic Latino adults and their children ages 8 to 16. Dr. Perreira serves as an adjunct professor in the Departments of Maternal and Child Health, Health Policy and Management, and Health Behavior at the Gillings School of Global Public Health. Please join me in welcoming our distinguished panelists. Each panel member will share a 20-minute presentation. Following the presentations, we will take questions and comments from our studio participants, as well as our audience online. Those of you viewing today's live webcast may ask questions via email, Twitter, or Facebook at any time. The email address is nherw@nciph.unc.edu. Tweet us at #NHERWCarolina. Or through our Facebook page at facebook.com/NHERW. To ensure a shared understanding of adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs, we invite you to watch a brief video that features educational media from two documentaries, Paper Tigers and Resilience, The Biology of Stress and the Science of Hope, which highlights ACEs and the science of resilience. We wanted to make sure everyone was familiar before we start the panel presentations, hoping to move beyond this foundational framework today and broaden the scope of ACEs to include more sources of trauma, adversity, and importantly, resilience.
What does your parents' divorce have to do with your risk for heart disease? If your mother had a drinking problem when you were growing up, are you more likely to suffer from depression as an adult? Here's what you should know about ACEs. ACEs stand for Adverse Childhood Experiences, extremely stressful events that can happen to a child growing up. Some experiences are so stressful that they can alter brain development, as well as the immune system, increasing the risk of lifelong health and social problems in adulthood. The term comes from the Adverse Childhood Experiences Study, landmark research that shed new light on the root cause of everything from stroke and liver disease to substance abuse and mental illness. In the late 1990s, an epidemiologist from the Centers for Disease Control and a preventive medicine doctor at Kaiser Permanente set out to understand the association between childhood experience and lifelong health. They asked over 17,000 people in the Kaiser Health Plan in San Diego about their health history, as well as difficult questions about their experiences growing up. Anda and Felitti tallied up 10 different kinds of adversity in this largely middle-class and college-educated population. They were stunned to see how common ACEs were. 21% of all respondents were sexually abused as children. 19% grew up with someone who suffered mental illness. 28% had been physically abused. And 2 out of 3 respondents had experienced at least one ACE. The researchers next looked at how someone's ACE score, or the number of adversities they experienced, related to a wide array of serious health and social problems. They saw that the more ACEs someone had, the greater their risk for poor outcomes compared with someone with no ACEs. Someone with an ACE score of 4 had twice the risk of heart disease and cancer. Someone with an ACE score of 5 had an 8 times greater chance of being an alcoholic. And those with an ACE score of 6 or more, on average, died 20 years earlier. With every major problem they looked at in the ACE study, the risk went up for each additional adverse experience in childhood. As Dr. Robert Anda says, what's predictable is preventable. It's important to remember that ACEs are not destiny. ACEs are a tool for understanding the health of a population as a whole. For individuals, an ACE score can be a tool for understanding their own risk for health and social problems, and empower them to make changes for themselves and their children. ACEs tend to get passed down from generation to generation and are common across all income levels, races, and cultures. But increasingly, people of all different professions and backgrounds are coming together to discuss how ACEs affect their communities. They're finding new ways to treat and prevent ACEs. Many doctors are starting to screen their patients for ACEs as part of their medical history. More schools are becoming trauma-informed, considering the source of problem behavior when disciplining their students instead of immediately suspending or expelling them. To learn more about interrupting the cycle of adversity and improving health and well-being for the next generation, please visit kpjrfilms.co.
And now we will hear from today's first presenter, Kanwarpal Dhaliwal, as she discusses radical inquiry.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. Hi. Great to see this crowd, and hello, everyone out there. I've never done this before, so I'm really excited. Thank you for letting me be up here the first time. I always want to start with an appreciation and a thank you to the ancestors, ancestors who fought for my survival, for our survival, ancestors by blood, by kin, by history. None of us would be in this room without folks who didn't break the mold and show up and forge what it means to be leading with love, rage, and liberation as we do at the RYSE Center. So thank you. Also want to thank, yes, we can clap to that. I also want to thank the young people in Richmond, California, the RYSE members right now. It's about 11 o'clock there, so they'll be coming in the next hour or so to RYSE. But RYSE is built on the organizing of young people of color to address the most sort of dehumanizing conditions of violence in their communities, really pushing on and calling on adults to do right. I'm here because there were 14 and 15 and 18-year-olds who were thinking about legacy for 7-year-olds, 8-year-olds, and so always have to make sure and bring them. Also, especially today in this time, part of what I want to talk about is sort of, and have us think about is what it means to sort of come to our own sort of political awakening, and how that comes up and where does that intersect in our training as public health professionals? Where might it get in the way? Because it will get in the way. So how do we think beyond that? How do we push the systems that protect us in the current state that we're in, but also really work with them in a liberatory way? So with that, I think actually I want to really thank particularly today Drs. Anita Hill. That was my political awakening for sure as a 16-year-old, and certainly Dr. Christine Blasey Ford, who I believe is a UNC alum. All right, okay. Just really particularly today, I also just want to be honest is I'm holding a lot of rage and anger at what I'm seeing. And I know I'm not the only one, so that makes me feel better. But just want to allow it in the space. Don't deny it, because the rage is what's going to get us through. Okay? So that said, I want to show you a 2-minute video about RYSE that was made by our members. So there's not any adults in it. So I'm going to show you that and then come back.
When I'm inside the RYSE, I just feel really safe and comfortable.
There's a place where you can just come and like not have to deal with stuff that's happening out the street or like violence in the community.
It's a happy environment. Everybody's nice to everybody. It's all love.
Everybody here is positive.
Everybody's so creative here. Being around that type of stuff, especially younger people that's creative, makes you want to be more creative.
We get so many different people from so many different like walks of life and so many different experiences coming to one space.
I wanted to rap, record music, and have my own CD and everything. RYSE has actually made it a reality.
I do film, so I always ask people for advice that do film here. You should come here to do something that you're not doing at home.
Yeah, I started off really bad. And once I started coming to RYSE, they helped me with school, they helped me with my career. They gave me a place to be where I feel like I can belong.
Everything here, we take in a restorative justice approach. They don't look at you for what you've done in the past or anything like that.
I became an intern, so that kind of changed the way I was in school. I started getting my grades up by going to just doing homework and making it in career plan.
We have a youth organizing club where a whole bunch of youth from the center or from the community can come together and pitch campaigns on how they want to change whatever it is in the community.
RYSE's goal is to empower youth to make a change.
I ultimately believe RYSE is here to expand young people's minds and show them what else the world has to offer.
People should come to RYSE because there's something for everybody at RYSE. I feel like there's a space for every single person in the community to be able to get something out of RYSE.
RYSE has so many things it can teach you. It can give you so many different jewels.
RYSE definitely helped me realize that I could actually do something, that I could accomplish what I had in my mind.
Thank you for taking a minute or two to watch. You can clap too, I don't mind. It's all good. So I want to share a little bit about that video. So a few things. One is we had a video that we created when we first opened, which is actually 10 years ago this October, which had a lot of adults in it and talking about what we could and needed to do for young people. And so our members and our staff came to us and said, it's time to create something that's really based from our experience. And we know y'all are going out there talking about what we do and who we are. We can't go with you all the time. We don't want to go with you all the time, but we want to make sure we can share who RYSE RYSE is from our vantage point. So that is why we bring RYSE everywhere we go, and you hear from the young people. We're located in Richmond, California. Anyone from Richmond? Yeah? Right on. All right. Town's in the house. We are up the street from Oakland, across the bay from San Francisco. We are a community of about 100,000 people. So we, as you can see, are full of creativity, love, joy, pain, fortitude, dreams, and hopes. And so that is all that we hold as an organization committed to the liberation of young people. We also created this video because what we know from the young people we work with, that when we're talking about issues around health equity, violence prevention, intervention, one of the things we hear over and over again is the media narrative about who young people of color are or are not in our community feels just as harmful as interpersonal violence. Right? So how do we start to even shift the structural lens around sort of how do we intervene the media, right? Channel 2 News, Channel 5 News, versus trying to figure out how do I change behaviors when I'm not paying attention to the context in which these behaviors are being decided. And so that is our work as an organization, to hold the acute pain and needs and dreams of young people while also making sure we're shining the light on the systems that continue to dehumanize them. And so in that spirit, I come to you with both a sense of tenderness and stridency. Tenderness in our ability to really hold beloved community with each other, to come to a place from our heart, from our vulnerability, and to be able to think critically from our places of privilege, from our places of subjugation. And that's what we do and are committed to as an organization. And I'm here today because we do identify as a public health organization. We both employ many of the sort of key elements and practices, but I think our work is also to really push. And public health as a field is not liberatory. We say that pretty clearly. That can be maybe another webcast, but that's our assumption. So while there's elements like social determinants of health, which we think are important, it really is about structural sort of structural issues of dis-ease for the most structurally vulnerable communities. And how do we shift some of that framework and language and shift the burden of responsibility of those communities that are most protected by our systems? So, going into conditions and context. So I think it's important when we're talking about health equity, research, resilience, that we understand or at least assert and name the framework and the context that we're in. So we're a community-based organization. We are grounded in our community, in our city. We provide programming across community health, media, art, and culture, education and justice, and youth organizing. And all of our programs are really held in frameworks of racial justice, healing, and trauma-informed approaches. So for us, a young person should be able to come to RYSE and feel like whatever activity they're doing, whether it's 3 or 10 or 0, it feels like one program. And that they know that whatever space they go in, they're going to be met with love, dignity, and respect. Because we live in a community where that is just not true. We live in a nation where that is not true. So what we know is that in our work, most of the research, social science research, public health research, funding, investment, has this incessant focus on changing behaviors, right? It is killing us, this focus on changing behaviors. We need that to stop right now. Systems violence is the root of all violence, and that is what we need to address. I talked about the narratives of young people and young people of color. Again, we see this in the research, in the funding, in the policy, in the interventions. That is assumed that we are risk, we are disease, we are criminal. And you can use whatever language. It can be either very direct and blatant, but it can also be coded in things like increasing our self-efficacy, reducing our risk. All these kind of things that are about containing Black and brown peoples and Black and brown young people are coded in the language. So our work is to understand that, to use it, but to be able to shift it and pivot it again to create more liberatory spaces for all of us. I want to talk about compliance. So today, started thinking about compliance. There's two things I want to read. I didn't want to forget. When we were planning for this, we were sent a few questions, and I couldn't make the first call. So I was told I need to respond in writing. So I stayed compliant with that. And one of the questions was like, what led us to this work? And so I wanted just to read this before I talk a little bit more about that. And
that I grew up with all my material needs met and in an atmosphere of racial terror and family violence. I coped by doing my best to stay compliant to conditions that were harmful: school, family, country, good grades, athlete, followed rules, student government. My protective factors and compliance were also where I experienced much pain. My parents taught me to do what is right, even when no one else will stand with me, to always be of service, to never take for granted the blessings of food, shelter, and education. I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful that I came to a place in my adolescence where I realized my compliance will not save or secure my livelihood, my humanity. Thank you, Dr. Anita Hill. So I started acting out in school, engaging in the most risky behaviors that public health loves to scrutinize and pathologize, and it's the risk where I felt the most free. When my ulcers and my migraines, my depression started going away, where my self-esteem and my agency increased. So I felt my best when I resisted the system. So resilience, survival, I was already resilient, but resistance felt like freedom. So what does it mean for us across our sort of education, our professional work, our trajectories to think about resistance as the aim? Resistance as part of liberation. Resilience is important, but I want to be clear that for Black and Brown communities, Black and Brown peoples in this country, resilience is a given. It is our baseline, not our benchmark. And so I don't want us to get caught in having to start somewhere that's not relevant and reflective for our lives, right? And I also want to say for white folks in the room, in the work, right? There's a way also resilience does need to be built. We need you to build your resilience to disrupt the structures that protect you. And so that's the shift that we're looking for. And as an organization, we feel it, we live it, we die it. Not die, D-I-E-T, die it. But we're in it, right? We feel it. I can feel my heart palpitating right now faster just because of, again, that love and that rage that fuels our liberation and our work. ACES. Does everyone know about ACES? You should all raise your hand because we just watched a video, unless you didn't watch it. We're glad there's ACES. RYSE is happy there's ACES. We have something else we can cite in our work. But I don't want us to put the, you know, our sort of organizational sort of success on the hook of something that we've known for centuries and decades. Those of us in movement work have known what happens to us that way impacts our health, our bodies. And so it's important, but it's kind of like, well, welcome. Welcome, science. Welcome, research, to what we know and what we live every day. And again, for those of us who are in training, this is where I want us to sort of the call to action to not forget that lived experience and that lived expertise, and that that needs to interact with how we're being formally trained. I don't know how much time I have. Okay, I'll keep going. So I want to offer 5 minutes. Okay, thank you. I want to offer an approach that we've taken as an organization because we think data research is important, right? We know we have chosen to be a 501c3, so we're in the world of sort of the nonprofit world where we have to get funding, we have to prove our case. We understand that. We've made that decision, and there's limitations to that. As we know, nonprofits set up to help keep capitalism. Right? We're the buffer class between the haves, the have-nots. So we have to understand that and be connected to movements that are really trying to rupture 501c3 industrial complex while we're still in it. So that said, we've taken on an approach we started calling radical inquiry, and that is making sure that everything we do is in service to and in proximity to the priorities, needs, and interests of young people of color. And that's not about giving a survey about priorities. It's about deep listening. It's about sitting in pain, sitting in vulnerability, being able to share that vulnerability. And so I put up here a few quotes that I hope help to sort of shift some of the frame, if we're in a different frame, around understanding that it really is sort of has to be community-based, community-birthed, in terms of what we call evidence, evidence-based approaches, et cetera. The most lasting and appropriate transmission of knowledge is in community through lived experience, right? It's not through a randomized controlled trial, which a lot of big institutions want to do now, how communities do, you know, RCTs around violence and violence prevention and, you know, nutrition. And it's like, but our lives are messy. We don't live that way. So why would we set up research to actually do that? Who is that in service to? It's not neat and tidy. So our research needs to be messy too. We need to make it is subjective. It has never not been subjective. So let's make it that and name it. I'm not going to read the other two because I want to go on to my time. I don't want to go over my time. Some key tenets of radical inquiry. That really it's grounded in the relationship and the healing. And that it is actually, it prevents transactional sort of work, right? Here's the unit of service. And it promises transformational work. So the way we've done this, it looks formal, it looks informal, it's in the music studio, it's in the garden, it's outside, it's with our clinicians, it's with adults who are working in service to young people. Radical inquiry is about systems change and structural change, not behavioral, right? So we ask young people what's going on for you, what's hard, what are you struggling with, or what do you hope? And then we create these data sets, and then these interventions that are, we need you to go change your behavior, when everything they're lifting up are the structures of inequity and dehumanization they live in. So I am remiss, I am doing harm if I am not doing work to address those conditions. So when we listen, when we think about radical inquiry, one form in which it took was we actually did a community engaged inquiry called our listening campaign. We talked to over 500 young people in our community about their experiences of violence, trauma, coping, and healing. And I'm going to share, these are just some of the key findings. But not one conversation when we asked about trauma did they say, what are you talking about? When we asked about stress, we don't know what you mean. It was like, you need to get clear on your questions. Right? You're talking about street violence, violence at school, by the police. Which one? You need to get clear, right? These are young people. But that said something for us that we had to listen to, and understanding it is atmospheric in our communities. My experience with violence is very brutal. I grew up with violence as if it were my sibling. Summary quote. What we heard over and over again from young people was, yeah, I know, like, I'm not supposed to engage. But what it means to disconnect also means a loss of friendship, of kinship, of safety, of protection. So as an organization, we realized we weren't doing a good job in also holding that loss. It was about getting away or thinking about a new way, but not acknowledging there's a loss here and the intimacy of that connection. I'm just going to share this. When we act about the impact and the coping, how do you deal? Smoking weed was the number one way, right? And this was, we had a lot of conversation, but we also did an open-ended survey where they just listed. So there wasn't any multiple choices, smoking weed. And it wasn't because it was fun or it felt good. It was to escape. It was to numb out, right? And if we use conventional research methods that then become interventions, if we looked at it through that lens, then it's, well, we need weed cessation classes all over Richmond, right? Well, the state of California now is hella white folks making hella money off weed. Right? So that's, again, addressing the structural is so important to name on the backs and deaths of our young people. Young people want agency. They want to be a part of it, but don't want to be overburdened. So often what we do also in our work is that we say, well, we want young people at the center of everything, but we don't equip them with the resources. We don't equip them with the space to hold their pain, to hold sort of, you know, their uncertainties. We don't do that. It's about show up to run this campaign and, oh, it's a win because we passed this ballot initiative, but your life is in shambles, but that doesn't matter. I can still call it a win and get more funding. That is violence. And so again, that's the call out to how do we really shift the understanding about what we're holding with love and rage and liberation, and how do we create metrics of liberation and get away from metrics of compliance. Realizing institutions don't work for you but against you is the first step to healing your community. So we ask people what they need. We need you to say it. We need you to say this stuff is set up not to actually tend to me. Right? That naming itself offers some relief. And even in my own, as I think about the connection to my own story, once I realize this isn't actually for me and I need to let go of trying to like contort myself to it, I can actually relax a bit and make some space for what feels right. And maybe do some critical thinking, right? So a very astute understanding. And they said, just naming it. I don't need you to solve it even. I just need you to say it. So I'm not going to make us all read this. I know my time's almost up. What was important for us is because we are, again, a public health organization, a health organization, mental health organization, you know, we have to respond to things that come out, like what's sort of like, you know, the fresh funding facts of the day, right? And so ACEs, trauma-informed care, it's everywhere now. So we get asked a lot about ACEs. How do you address ACEs? How do you screen? Well, trauma in our community is atmospheric. So our healing must be atmospheric. ACEs is not atmospheric. So I don't know if you can all see, but ACEs is in there. I think it's on the individual and interpersonal. ACEs is certainly a part of trauma and healing as we look at it through an atmospheric lens, but it is not the only thing. And if we only started from that place, we would remiss, again, the centuries of resilience we're already showing up with. And so I really, again, if I can say it 20,000 times, resilience is not our benchmark for those of us who come from structurally vulnerable communities. Resilience is a benchmark for those who have been structurally protected. You all got work to do. And I will say we got work to do. I'm an overeducated woman of color, so I have to be a part of that too. And make sure my training doesn't get in the way of liberation. And on that note, I just want to share, we do have a theory of liberation. So RYSE is created through our radical inquiry work, rather than a theory of change, a theory of liberation. And so our metrics match up to what that means. So our two domain systems are transformed and young people feel loved. And in those, we do all our work. And it's really important for us that our outcomes have to be bolder, braver than anything that's out there. There's no funder outcome. There's no research outcome that is going to match up to the lived experiences and expertise of us. There just isn't. We have to create them. What a gift, right? Especially for the students in here, but for all of us, right? Because we're never done learning. What a gift to be able to do that. And this is all I'll end with. Again, the RYSE community, thank you for listening. I look forward to the conversation and hearing from my colleagues.
Thank you, Kanwarpal, for a great presentation. We will now hear from Dr. Reese as he discusses when health equity is a verb, change happens.
So, good afternoon. I want to first thank my colleagues from the Gillings School, Global School of Public Health, for inviting me here, and my colleagues on the panel. Thank you for setting the bar so high. I really, really appreciate that.
Got you back.
Yeah, right? You're going to have it. So it's a pleasure to be here with you today. We were actually given some marching orders as we came into today's presentation, which was one, to not sugarcoat our discussion. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time presenting data, talking about models of change, et cetera. I appreciate the ability to be conversational with you, to talk to you, to listen to you, to learn from you, and preferably to offer you something that may be helpful to you. Much like the first presentation, I'm going to talk some about the systemic and structural pieces that underlie the challenges that our young people face, in part because I know that I am preaching to the converted. Y'all know this stuff, right? Y'all come up here and give a presentation about this and that and why that happens. That's not the conversation we need to have. The conversation we need to have is why we're still having the conversation. So I have a couple of objectives. One is to encourage us to think differently about how we understand health equity. We're aware of difference. And the other piece is to have us see health equity as a verb, not an adjective, such that its achievement requires action. It requires that we do something. We don't just get to talk about it. It requires that we give, we support, we stretch ourselves, we challenge other folks, et cetera. So the goal is to encourage you to think and to act critically. But as part of that, I want to spend some time deconstructing some terms, make a couple of assertions about some assumptions that drive me, and then share an example. The Robert Wood Johnson Foundation in 2017 used this definition for health equity. It says, this is when everyone has a fair and just opportunity to be healthier. It went on to say that in order to do this, you have to attend to poverty, discrimination, and their impact on health, that you have to remove those obstacles that are in the way of getting a quality education, having access to meaningful work that pays a fair wage, and to healthcare. Sounds reasonable, right? And they went on to say that that definition was informed by ethical and human rights principle. They framed it as a civil rights issue. Good, right? Here's the problem. In 1906, W.B. Du Bois said, with improved sanitary conditions, improved education, and better economic opportunities, the mortality of the race, and here he was referring to black folks, may and probably will steadily decrease until it becomes normal. Now, that was him making reference to a comparison to white folks. That's another conversation and another presentation that I don't have time to do today. But that's the definition of what? Health equity, all right? These comments were part of the proceedings of a conference on the health and physique of the Negro American. This was an early edition of the American Public Health Conference in 1906. So the history around this piece matters because it goes to the underlying hegemony and white supremacy that makes all this stuff happen. Why, over 100 years later, are we having the same conversation? Talking about the same things. Because we have allowed this to be an adjectival, a descriptive kind of phenomenon. My point is that only by going to an intentional, and I struggle with the word, using the word white supremacy, because, you know, people get in their feelings, it triggers, it activates folks and stuff like that. But sometimes, and they said we didn't have to sugarcoat it, so I'm following orders. This idea that this notion, this system, this way of thinking about the world and how it maintains legal, political, economic, educational, vocational, religious, and health privileges for white folks. You made reference to what was happening in D.C. right now. I mean, that's an example of how white supremacy works. You have a room full of white men making a decision about whether something that a woman says happened to her happened or not. I mean, that's not crazy to everybody in this room? All right. And so that in order for us to move the needle, we have to look inside. Public health has been very good at going to what's happening in housing, education, employment, the food stores in your neighborhoods, et cetera. We have done a horrible job at looking at what we do within public health. I found this piece as I was preparing for today. It said, disease does not discriminate, but public health does. It went on to say that a nation built on the back of slave labor and the lands of indigenous people had made for a public health system that advances at the expense of people of color. That's what we should be talking about. Whose theories are we studying? What public health practices are we engaging in? How do we reward? What does faculty accountability look like? In most places, it looks like how many publications did you get? How many grants did you get? How many student theses or dissertations did you advise, et cetera? I'm not saying that there's anything inherently wrong with those in some combination, but that has nothing to do with making a meaningful difference in the lives of people. And people are dying because we are not doing our job. All the while, we have people whose careers are made because of health disparities. Mm-hmm. We have buildings that have been built on the grant monies that institutions have gotten through indirect costs that build new buildings, but people are dying. The conversation around looking at those structural pieces and how we change and manage those structural pieces is the conversation that we have to have. Public health has to be clear about these things. Why we do what we do? Who's it for? To whom do we do it? And who gets to decide that? I can't tell you how many times, most of my work focuses on pediatric populations, primarily African-American males. How often I go into a room having done this work for 25 years and I am the only one that looks like me in the room. While folks are making decisions about my sons, my nephews, my cousins. Who gets to decide? Where are the decision makers and where do they come from? And where do they go when they leave? They're not coming to my neighborhood. Now, mind you, from my position of privilege at this point, my circumstances are radically different than they were 30 years ago. And I'm grateful for that. But even in my current situation, the people who make decisions about what does and does not happen in public health and preventive medicine do not come to my neighborhood. Who isn't at the table and why? You talked a lot about listening to the voices of young people. We use young people. Mm-hmm. We pimp young people. Mm-hmm. We put them out there as a prop to say that we're engaged with community and young people. But if we were really listening to young people, we would be paying attention to why they have to smoke a blunt to numb their pain,
That's right?
Or why they're sleeping all day because they're depressed, but they can't get quality behavioral health services. Mm-hmm. Or why in Atlanta, where I'm from, that people have to go to jail, juveniles have to go to jail to get quality behavioral health. That's crazy. If I refer out to a psychiatrist right now, it's a 2 to 3 month wait. If you get adjudicated through the juvenile justice system where I live and practice at, you will be seen by a psychiatrist within a week. Does that make sense to anybody? So again, it's these systems. And then this last piece is, not only who is not at the table, what is it that we aren't doing that we should be and why? And why aren't we asking those questions? See, we can't talk about anybody else in public health until we begin to, in earnest, take a look at what we do. And the other piece I want to say about equity is that equity, by its very nature, is antithetical to the structure of this country. Mm-hmm. The definition I read to you earlier says when everybody has a fair opportunity, I'd scratch my hair, but I ain't got none. That assumes that you're willing to give up something in order for it to be fair. We like talking about these issues around social justice and health equity and economic equity, et cetera, until it requires that we give up something. I was listening to NPR the other day, and this woman was talking about, she said, these Republican policies are actually better for my bank account. She was being honest. She said, but it does not reflect my moral bank account. I was like, wow, that's deep. I said, you just got your way into my presentation. Thank you. Because it reflects this idea that if I am to live my values, what's in my heart, then it requires that I give up something. That I might pay a little bit more taxes. That there will be a distribution where there's more equity in the quality of education that not only do my kids receive, but their kids receive as well. It costs me something. So equity requires that you give up something. And I think that one of the things that we have to be thinking about as we talk about health equity, what are you willing to give up? What are you willing to do different? To further make this point around what people are willing to give up and not give up is this business case for racial and health equity. This was done by the Kellogg Foundation. It was done nationally, and this report's on 2018 data, but they also did this for 2013. Here's what they found, that if you were to eliminate health disparities, you would, there would be a potential economic gain of $135 billion. Billion. $93 billion of that would be in the number of people who use the emergency department as their primary health care home, because they would have health insurance. $42 billion would be realized in untapped productivity. The U.S. economy would be $2 trillion larger by 2015 if the educational achievement of Black and Latino children was raised to that of white children. If it's all about the economy, stupid. I mean, like, seriously, this is real stuff. State and federal prisons' costs will be cut by $30 billion annually if Black and Latino folks were incarcerated at the rate of white folks. I'm not going to do a deep dive on that, but that speaks for itself. So remember, this was done in 2013 and 2018. So the question is why aren't we implementing what we know here? I actually think that we're making the wrong argument. So if we make the argument that you got to give up something, yeah. But if I make the argument that you get something, right? That the programs to help those in poverty may be less needed because of this, and that that we would compete better in the world economy because we would have a educated workforce that could do that, you might be more inclined to sign up. In the Black Belt, which runs across several states in the Deep South, Mercedes-Benz built a stadium, not stadium, that's Atlanta. Mercedes-Benz built a stadium in Alabama. Not a stadium, a plant. Focused on football, I'm sorry. But they built this factory in Alabama, and they said, in order for us to build this factory here, these schools have to change. Guess what happened? Schools changed, right? In fact, the state came in, took over the schools, got the schools together. They worked with the folks at Mercedes-Benz because Mercedes-Benz was saying, our employees who are going to work at this factory have to be well-educated. They have to be able to produce these automobiles, right? The thing that the state had not been willing to do up until then, when Mercedes-Benz pulled up and said, we will build a factory here because you're giving us these tax incentives, but this is the piece that has to happen. And what I want to suggest to you, for those of us in academia in particular, is that we have to stop engaging in that intellectual masturbatory behavior that has us impressed because of how many publications we got, mm-hmm. how many grants we got, mm-hmm. et cetera, because it doesn't change the quality of people's lives. And so I submit to you that we are asking some of the wrong questions. As I think about my own career, I have been associated with probably over $40 million in grants, and one way or another as an investigator, co-PI, PI, et cetera. Published a number of times. Produced this report in 2008 about resilience and strength in Black children and adolescents, which I thought was seminal. And we thought it was seminal because the American Psychological Association, up until that point, had not produced something that focused on Black youth in a positive way. So we thought we were doing something. It's on my shelf. The other members of the task force is on their shelf. It's a good document. There are good ideas in it. But the intent was never to have the ideas be implemented, because that's not how we set it up. We didn't set it up to say we're going to take the work that we're doing and make it have practical, meaningful implications for the communities that we care about. I probably have never worked on anything harder than that particular project. But in 1995, there was a program called It's My Choice. It was a program that engaged Black and brown kids in Chicago to make to understand drugs and early premature sexual involvement and all these things, and how to make good choices and be positively oriented to the future, and how to open doors and these other kind of things for themselves. That was started by myself and a colleague, Elizabeth Betta, who's now at Loyola University in Chicago. We started that program with $3,000. 25 years later, that program is still going, right? We didn't know what we were doing, but what happened is that the schools and the community-based organizations that we worked in, they liked what we were doing, and so they built within their institutions the capacity to sustain those programs. And then we did something practical that we also did. This was not planned, so this was by accident, where we started to help, because I'm out of a applied psychology program, we began to help our trainees understand that providing support to folks around behavioral health issues didn't happen in a therapy room with somebody sitting on your couch, that it could happen in the community with you interacting with some young people, leading a group or doing something with them in the community. Now we have practicum students who do their practicum in these settings through this program that was started in 1995, $3,000 versus the other millions of dollars that I've been involved with. We have to ask ourselves what difference our money, our services make with regard to what it is that we do. I want to take credit for this, but I can't. Brian Smedley came to our campus last year and talked about this idea of place-based investments and people-based investments. And he argued convincingly that health is a construction of society that is driven by economic factors. I'm a convert, I'm a witness. But what he was saying is where we invest our money matters, and who we invest in matters, and we shouldn't necessarily be investing our monies in academic institutions. We shouldn't necessarily be investing all of our money in professors and those of us who are in academia, because we don't go and we don't live in the communities where these challenges exist. There was a piece that somebody did actually just yesterday showed up, but they talked again about how place matters. Place matters. So I have just a couple more minutes here, but this idea of resilience. She all but cussed me out on our conference call when we started talking about resilience. She said, no, that's our baseline. We're not working towards resilience. That's who we are. And so this brother here, he was a MSW student at NYU, and he had used this in a paper. He said, I think that people already have resilience. I think that it's labeled in a way where they don't really understand that. Mm-hmm. If you just survive prison, if you survive waking up day in and day out, just maintaining to get through that, you're practicing resilience. And so I came across that since our conference call, and I'm like, I don't have to come up with some definition in some journal or some other kind of thing. This captures it better than anything. And to the point that was made earlier, so it's not those people, the black, brown, poor people, women, the LGBTQ people that we're talking about who need resilience. It is, in fact, our colleagues, our white colleagues, the institutions that they work in and that we work in that require that we attend to that. So what are some action steps? Because we talked about from awareness to action. For our citizen advocates, and this includes everyone, hold your policymakers and those who control budgets accountable. Understand that you have a right to be healthy. One of the other things that came up on one of our conference calls was you are entitled. We talk about white privilege. We're entitled to health. And then evaluate whether or not what you're doing is making an impact. There's talked about creating strategic coalitions. When the Parkland massacre happened and all those young people were tragically murdered, one of the people who became one of the spokespersons, he partnered with a couple of organizations working with youth of color. He said, his name is Cameron, I can't remember his last name right now, but he said, I understand I have privilege because I am white, and this happened in my white community, my upper middle class white community. So I'm going to partner with those who may not be given the same audience, the same access to talk about the same issues, violence, creating strategic partners. Students, again, this should include everyone. If you're in school, some of the people who you will learn the most from are not the ones who are teaching your class. That's real. Pay attention. Write it down.
Tweet it.
There you go. Demand to be taught and experience those things that make a difference. If it's easy, if you can get it because you're smart, you're not being stretched. And again, evaluate whether or not you're learning it will make a difference in the careers that you seek for yourself. And for everybody else, hold yourself accountable. Stop talking, start doing. Have meaningful measures of impact. If it doesn't make a difference, it's not meaningful. I've got a number of publications. This hurts to say, but that I'm sure didn't have a quantifiable impact in improving somebody's life. And again, understand that everybody has a right to health. And let's champion that right for everybody. Last one. Power concedes nothing without a demand and never did and it never will. Demand something. And then this piece from my colleagues at the McSilver Institute for Poverty Studies at NYU, they're doing this social media campaign on black boys and men. And they said, black boys and black men are, and you get to fill it in. And the notion was changing the narrative. And so my charge to you, my question to all of you here in the room and there on the internet is, what are you going to do to change the narrative for the things that you care most about? Thank you for your time, and I look forward to the conversation later.
Thank you, Dr. Reese, for your insights. I hope those of you who are abroad and in our audience are taking notes, because our presenters are dropping some knowledge in here for us today. Okay, back to the script. Our final presentation will be made by Dr. Krista Perreira, who will speak about building a healthy future for children of immigrants. Thank you.
All right, thank you. There we go. So again, thanks for inviting me to be here today. This has been an incredible panel so far, and I hope I don't do anything to change that. So with this presentation, I'm going to turn our attention towards immigration and the children of immigrants. And I'm going to give you a little sugar, a few facts and figures and frameworks, but then I'm going to strip away some of that sugar coating. So there are approximately 44 million foreign-born persons living in the United States today. They made up nearly 14% of the U.S. population in 2016. And these immigrants have moved to the United States from Latin America or the Caribbean, from Asia, from Africa, from Europe, and other world regions. They include voluntary migrants seeking to reunify with their families and improve their economic circumstances. And they include involuntary migrants, refugees, and political asylees fleeing persecution, violence, and war in their home countries. Most importantly for our discussion today, the families of immigrants include 18 million children with at least one foreign-born parent. In other words, over one quarter of our children in the U.S. have a parent that's an immigrant. Moreover, 88% of the children with a foreign-born parent are U.S.-born. They're U.S.-born children. Thus, the policies and practices affecting the well-being of foreign-born adults living in the United States have important consequences for the well-being of many U.S.-born children. So there's three frameworks are commonly used to understand the health of immigrants and their children. The stages of migration theory provides a practical framework for thinking about factors that can influence the health and adaptation of immigrants. It's organized to focus on how threats, strengths, and policies prior to migration, during migration, and after migration influence children's experiences and ultimately their well-being. These threats and strengths can be defined at different ecological levels: individual, family, school, societal. While some of the stresses, as you've already heard, associated with migration can be positive and tolerable, others can be toxic. Early childhood exposure to toxic stressors can disrupt healthy neurological and physiological development, thereby increasing the risk of stress-related disease and disorder, as well as increasing the risk of cognitive impairment and poor educational outcomes well into adulthood. Yet in the U.S., we are increasingly adopting policies which make it harder for immigrants and their families to transition to life in the U.S., and which increase the likelihood that children of immigrants will experience toxic stress. In our research on migration and the health of children, we also turn to ideas of acculturation, enculturation, and acculturative stress. But this research has been limited in many respects. We have tended to focus on how immigrants perceive their migration experiences and sources of stress post-migration. However, in our modern era, we forget that we are constantly exporting American cultures and acculturation processes. And those acculturation processes can begin before arrival to the U.S. Additionally, cultures in immigrants' countries are continually, in countries of origin, they're continually changing. And immigrants do not inevitably lose contact with their cultures of origin once they migrate. They live increasingly transcultural lives and negotiate their belonging within multiple groups that transcend borders. And finally, as we consider acculturative stress, we tend to emphasize the sources of stress or threats to well-being rather than the sources of resilience or resources for coping. In a political environment where immigrants and their children are bombarded by messages that marginalize and dehumanize them, we need to refocus our lens on resilience, but a different type of resilience. To build a healthy future for children of immigrants, we must consider how to build resilient communities. Communities that welcome immigrants, see them as a source of strength, facilitate their integration, and foster their talents. Though the deleterious consequences of acculturative stress have been a mainstay in the literature, surprisingly few studies have actually documented differences in acculturative stress across different immigrant groups. Here, focused on legal status, we see evidence that the fear of deportation, that last set of bars, has become a primary concern among adults from various immigrant backgrounds. And this was in 1999. More recent evidence from a national survey of 1,400 Hispanic Latino adults indicates that regardless of their legal immigration status, fear leads many to avoid common activities of daily life. Evidence from studies of children of immigrants with parents who are unauthorized immigrants further suggests that this fear shapes all aspects of their lives, family, work, school, and ultimately health. Moreover, this is something we can change. Unauthorized status and the fear of deportation are defined by our legal system and magnified by the choices that we make in our local immigration and enforcement practices. Finally, our research has only begun to recognize that immigrants experience a variety of vulnerabilities that accumulate across stages of migration as well as across the life course. These sources of vulnerabilities are numerous. These vulnerabilities change with age and across cohorts of immigrants. These vulnerabilities also differ between settlement locations. But one particular concern is how federal, state, and local policies magnify the vulnerabilities of children of immigrants. Over the past 10 years, the federal government and many state and local governments have enacted policies that increasingly marginalize immigrants, especially those who are undocumented, and consequently their U.S. citizen-born children. We have restricted their access to the labor market, we have restricted their access to higher education, and we have restricted their access to basic health and human services. Through their words and actions, various levels of government have signaled quite strongly that they will not support the incorporation of many immigrants into U.S. society. Although these policies target immigrants, they have widespread consequences for all U.S. citizens, especially those from racial, ethnic, and religious minority populations. They perpetuate fear and create a sense of threat for anyone whose skin color is not white, who speaks with an accent, who fails to conform to the dominant behavioral and phenotypical expectations of American. And research evidence has begun to document the negative consequences of our restrictive laws and policies. In our past research on health of the children of immigrants, we have highlighted the existence of a paradox. despite coming from poor socioeconomic circumstances and the perils of migration, immigrants have appeared healthier than U.S.-born natives. Although this paradox could potentially be explained by something that we call selection effects in migration, evidence suggests that this is not the case. This leaves us with the reality that for many Americans, health declines across immigrant generations, and for the first generation with time in the U.S. As immigrants become American, they become disadvantaged. They become minorities, and they become less healthy. But the story can be more complicated than that for many children of immigrants. In fact, Asian and Hispanic children of immigrants report higher rates of fair to poor self-reported health than their U.S.-born counterparts and U.S.-born whites. Among Hispanics and Asians, the children of immigrants engage in less physical activity, perhaps afraid to go outside. And among Hispanics, the percent overweight is higher among children with immigrant parents than with children with U.S.-born native parents. In short, the children of immigrants are less healthy in comparison to those with U.S.-born parents than we previously imagined. At the same time, we do find the traditional paradoxical result that children of immigrants are less likely to be diagnosed with chronic conditions. Though much of this could be explained by access to health care, this was true even after accounting for access to health insurance. Additionally, we find that children of immigrants are less likely to have behavioral and emotional problems than children of U.S. natives. But digging deeper, we find that among children of immigrants, those children with one or more unauthorized immigrant parents are vulnerable to greater symptoms of both internalizing problems like anxiety and depression, as well as externalizing problems like aggressive behavior. So these emotional and behavioral health risks may reflect the very rational and daily fear that children of immigrants live with, the fear that one or both of their parents could be deported. The negative consequences of parental deportations begin at the community level, leaving immigrant communities split in two, increasingly separated from mainstream society and isolated from resources that could be used to support their families and children. For families and parents that bear the burden of deportation, the results are family separation, family conflict, residential instability, increased economic stress, and increased psychological distress. These stressors then limit the capacity of families and parents to provide the support their children need. The children themselves face fear, stigma, reduce access to health services and social services, and especially for older children, family obligations, increased family obligations, caring for their brothers and siblings when their parents have been deported. These stressors limit the health of children. Each of these, layered upon one another, hinder the healthy development of the children of immigrants. Some of these negative health consequences could be remedied by improving access to health insurance and health care. The children of immigrants are more likely to have no health insurance. Hispanic children of immigrants are more likely to have received no preventive health services in the past 12 months. They are also more likely to have received no mental health care. Access to health insurance and consequently health care is especially limited for children who are unauthorized immigrants. And while the ACA has led to some improvements in access to affordable health insurance for lawfully present immigrants, unauthorized immigrants are most often left out. And there are continued calls to roll back the ACA to roll back pre-existing condition coverage, among others. The responsibility for caring for these immigrants and their children is thus borne by community health centers and county health departments. The burden experienced by community health centers and county health departments may be especially large in many states that have substantial immigrant populations and choose not to expand Medicaid. They're shown here in dark blue, and North Carolina is one of those states. These burdens can be especially large in many states that do not provide access to public health insurance coverage for qualified, lawfully residing immigrant children during what we call the five-year ban established through welfare reform in 1996. And those states are highlighted here in light blue. As a result of welfare reform in 1996, most lawfully present immigrants cannot receive Medicaid for the first 5 years of their residency, unless the state opts to fund them with state-only funds. These burdens can also be especially large in many states that have chosen not to provide prenatal care for immigrant women not eligible for Medicaid during that five-year ban. Those are also here in light blue. But even so, access to health insurance does not guarantee access to health care. The lack of linguistically and culturally appropriate medical care, the lack of public transportation and driver's licenses, and the fear of contact with police and other public officials can keep immigrants from obtaining the care that they and their children need for healthy, productive lives in the U.S. So while additional research and evidence on which to base improvements in our policies and practices are essential, to build a healthy future for the children of immigrants and for all Americans, it is even more essential that each of us become advocates for change. Personal resilience is part of what we need to achieve change. Many of you in this audience, I'm sure, have a story to share about overcoming challenges, defying the odds through your own personal resilience. Absolutely. But we must move beyond interventions which promise to build up our personal resilience, to teach us a few new skills or a few new tricks to help us cope. Resilience should not be about making you or making me better at coping with a toxic environment. Mm-hmm. Resilience that matters is about us and changing the context in which we live. Resilience lies in the power to lock your hands together, our hands together, against those who would separate us, who would marginalize us as African, Asian, or Hispanic, or white American, as citizen or non-citizen, as documented or not documented, as deserving or undeserving. We are all deserving. We are deserving of respect, deserving of equal rights, and deserving of equal protection under the law. Resilience is about dismantling policies of exclusion that perpetuate fear and perpetuate a racialized history of inequality in the United States. Resilience is about building welcoming and inclusive communities. And so I ask you to make a promise to partner with each other to build welcoming and inclusive communities. And I ask you to promise yourself and to promise everybody in this room that you will go out and vote on November 6th. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Perreira. Please join me in thanking all three of our presenters for their insightful and informative presentations. We will now take a 5-minute break, so please feel free to stand and stretch while we prepare for the second half of today's webcast. When we return, our panelists will answer questions from our audience here in the auditorium, as well as those watching online. We've now moved to the question and discussion portion of the program. Please email your questions and comments to nherw@nciph.unc.edu. Tweet them to #NHERWCarolina or through our Facebook page at facebook.com/NHERW. We invite those assembled here in the studio audience to use one of the microphones set up in the aisles. We suggest writing out your question so that you can state it clearly and concisely. And now our first question from our online audience will be read by Gillings doctoral student Brooks Daly.
Hi. So our first question comes from Twitter. We have a group watching at Tulane University. So the question is directed at Dr. Reese, but we love to hear from all of the panelists. They write, accountability can have different meanings for populations and people. How exactly can we hold those in power accountable?
I'd stretch my mouth first. So the question came from a group of students, right?
Mm-hmm. They didn't say it. It's, we just have a group of people watching at Tulane.
Sure. So let's assume that they're students, since they're at Tulane. The faculty and institution is there because of them, not the other way around. And so they get to ask questions and have requirements of their institutions that should compel those institutions to make sure that they're getting what it is they need. I think we talk at and talk down to our students too often instead of saying, how do we partner? I mean, and we do the same thing in community. And so the accountability piece is everybody getting what they need or as close to that as we can get? And I think if it's one-sided, then we have a problem. So it's leaning too heavily towards faculty problem, leaning too heavily towards students problem, not including community problem. And so if we're in it together, then we have to do it together. And I think that the accountability piece is about the conversation that we have that makes us as faculty responsive to students, but also then holds our students to a standard of accountability in terms of if you're asking for this, then you're going to, we're going to partner in figuring out how to do it so you don't get to make the ask or have the complaint without being part of the solution. That's where I would start.
Yeah, I'm going to add to that a little. You know, I think this is an incredibly important question, and I think you have to, in part, change the incentives. You have to change the accountability structure so that members of the community that are relevant, that our institutions are supposed to be serving, are in positions of power in those institutions and on boards of directorships and in, you know, and the governor's board and et cetera, et cetera. So we have to change those systems of power. And one thing that, you know, federal qualified health centers do, which helps give them more of a say, more accountability back to the community, is they require that community members, people who are using the federally qualified health centers, be on their boards of directors. So we have to, for institutions to become more accountable, they have to be more inclusive of the members of the community that they're supposed to be serving.
You know, actually at Morehouse, one of the things that we have is we have a community coalition board that's connected to our prevention research center. And any research that goes through our PRC cannot be pursued without it first being vetted with the Community Coalition Board, which is always chaired by a member of the community and involves Morehouse faculty, involves representatives from different agencies, but also there's a heavier presence of citizens from the community. So to your point, I think that when we share power, quote unquote, that we get better outcomes.
I would add to what my colleague said and saying that I think part of it's also shifting, again, the inquiry of outcomes, what's meaningful for those most proximate. So if we're talking about a public health school, the students are most proximate. It's exactly what LeRoy had said, that what's most meaningful in terms of students feeling successful, feeling like they've been able to move through, building on their resilience, right, in whatever form it takes. And then figuring out what does that look like from those of us, and I speak about myself as an executive at the organization, how do I sort of show up to that? So what does transparency look like, right? And then how do we evaluate that across all systems? So we do an annual survey with all our members, and it really is asking, are we living our values as an organization? So one, I think systems, agencies, organizations need to be clear about their values. And how are they enacted? But we also do the same thing with our staff. Do staff feel like we are showing up with our values and that they feel held and tended to as well in service to our membership? And then also with our partners. So I think we have to think about the sites of inquiry. And I think this is where, again, shifting from, we cannot rely on the way current systems set up accountability, right? And so that's, we're always sort of hedging, like, how much do we rely, how much do we agitate, but also how do we build our own systems and cultures? And I think that's what excites us at RYSE. That's what excites us sort of in the work and the worlds we're in.
Thank you. I just want to remind our in-house audience that we have two microphones, one to my left in the back and one to my right. So please feel free to step up to the mic to ask some questions. And in the meantime, we'll go back to Brooke for another online question.
So we have an email question from Becky. What approaches have you found effective for programs that want to reach out to community members who experience disparities in health equity / underserved populations?
What are the best approaches? Well, one is, again, I would say is the priorities and needs of communities have to be driven and grown in the communities. So I think part of it is like, is it even wanted or desired? Are there these interventions by institutions, academia, research, philanthropy, are they actually wanted? And how will they not do more harm, which they often do, or we often do? So I think that's like an initial question. I mean, honestly, sometimes, and I say this like, you know, again, with all the tenderness and stridency I have, that systems get in the way. We've been living this long in this country that's not meant for us, that was built off the blood, sweat, and tears of many of our ancestors, that relying on sort of systems or institutions is actually something that we are ambivalent about.
Part of what I would add to that is I think relationships help with engaging, but relationships don't happen in a month or 2 months. Are 3 months. So relationships take time. And so I think that when you partner with somebody, it means you're willing to spend time, that you're willing to kind of take off whatever your cloak is on campus, for example, and join with and be a part of the community. And it also requires that you listen. You know, I tell folks all the time, listen more and say less, and you'll understand what's really going on. And so I think that as we develop relationships to the point you're making, we can figure out what's important. We can figure out what partnerships look like. We can figure out whether or not we have a role. And sometimes what we need to do is sit on the sideline, and that's actually how we engage. We support. We go work somewhere in the community, not doing what we do in our day job, because that's what the community needs. And I think that when we're willing to whoever the we is, I'm referring to myself in this instance, take off our privilege, you know, the assumptions that drive how we see ourselves and just be with folks, that really kind of helps kind of join with folks, and that makes for better work all the way around.
Okay, we'll now have two questions from our in-house audience.
What's going on, everybody? My name is Malik Francis. I go to St. Augustine's University. I'm a junior. This is for all three. I really appreciate all three of y'all because obviously exactly what's going on. The slides that you were showing with the statistics and the bars and everything. All right, so one of the slides, I know we were talking about immigrants, but one of the slides said that black U.S. citizen kids had more Medicaid than any other group, period. Do you think that it would be altered in a way since that's a discount technically? Because I know if I go to Dollar Tree, they still have Swiss rolls, but it's cheaper, but it's still the same thing. You know? But it's real though. Like, so do you think it's altered any kind of way?
So I'm trying to figure out which slide that you're talking about first.
It may have been the third. I believe the third slide. I just realized that when it had black at the bottom, had U.S. citizens, it skyrocketed like out of nowhere. So I was just asking, do you think that it was altered in any way? And if so, do you think that it's really being targeted to that specific group?
Can you clarify what you mean by altered?
The medicine.
The quality.
The quality, yeah, the quality of the care, like.
So you're getting, if I may.
Right, help. Yeah, you go ahead, go ahead.
It sounds like he's asking, is that quality, even though they're receiving the service, is the quality the same?
Yeah, because obviously we're receiving more of the service. So if it's a discount or a coverage, would it be diluted?
Right.
Is it, you know? That's just something I want to, you know.
You like asking easy questions, don't you?
Well,
I like to ask the right question.
So I was trying to figure out what slide you were thinking about because, there was one slide on the receipt of mental health care where U.S. citizen blacks are very high, and it's because they do not receive mental health services. Okay. So for most of the topics that I was talking about, unfortunately, you know, I'm always sad to see that U.S. citizens who are African American are often on the low side of getting services,
right.
and we don't meet their needs.
And I understand with that because, you know, the coverage, you know, we probably don't have the most money, you know, but with that being said, I was just asking, do you think it's altered in any kind of way?
So we have a problem regardless of your insurance type,
right,
with
right.
the quality of care that people who are black, brown, and poor receive.
Of course.
Regardless of Medicaid, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, Aetna, et cetera. That's one piece.
Right.
It's a challenging question, one, because I don't know that we have good data on that. Certainly there are those providers. So, for example, I'm a Medicaid provider.
Right.
I do work. The person who comes in to see me with Medicaid gets the same quality of care as the person who's the fee-for-service person who comes in to see me for care. I have colleagues like that, mm-hmm. you know, who may not do full-time practices in which they see Medicaid, but they set aside a couple of days a week that they call public sectors where they feel like this is a way for them to kind of give back.
Right.
I'm thinking of a couple of psychiatrists I work with in particular who do this. And I think about those folks, and those would be the people that my kids would go to, right? They're as good as it gets. Mm-hmm. And so I can't speak for the entire universe of providers who see patients through Medicaid. I know that there are some problems there, and that's because there's a lot to that. Because I don't think that there's good monitoring and accountability around the quality of care people are getting in any way.
Right.
And I think particularly sometimes within that particular system, that may be true. But I do think you can get quality care by people who see Medicaid patients. I do think that in some states, like Georgia, for example, Medicaid is actually provides decent coverage. So it depends.
Okay. And I have one. I'm sorry. No, you have time?
Yeah, for the sake of time.
It's cool. Okay, that's fine.
Okay, but thank you, though. Thank you. So we're going to take another question. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kay Savage. I'm also here on behalf of St. Augustine's University in Raleigh, North Carolina. I'm a senior. My question is for all three of you, and it's really about, like, what point in you guys' career where you were like, resilience is not the end. Resilience is something I do every day. At what point in you guys' career were you like, I'm turning this around. This is not what I want to see in my field. What was the straw that broke the camel's back that inspired you to start RYSE? That Dr. Reese, you said $40 million had came across your hands, and you even made the realization up there that you were like, you know what, some of the research that I did didn't even really help anybody. So like, what was the straw that broke the camel's back that you were like, you know what, I'm turning this around right now?
I'm really glad you think we're turning it around. Let me just say that. That gives me a lot of hope and joy. So thank you for saying that. And, you know, I'm here as a steward of an organization, of a community, of a broader community of folks really trying to do the righteous work. And I feel really grateful. And there's ways, like I said, and I read the excerpt from childhood, you know, it's like there's things you know in your gut, right? And I think for so much, it's like you just kind of know it, but you don't have language. And then somebody or something gives meaning to it. And that's, for me, what's been so liberatory in different places. Like, it happens in a way I don't think it's going to happen. I'll also say, you know, RYSE 10 years ago, we couldn't say all the things we said in the way we said them. We have some of the capital and currency now in our community to be this strident, to have a theory of liberation that we assert. We couldn't do that in year one or year three. So there is something about how are we tactical, right? How are we strategic? How do we stay in community? But it is constantly being proximate, listening, right? And so every time we're engaging with the systems, whether it's, you know, local health department, with a funder, with other agencies, it's we're always centering what we're there for. So when it starts to sort of, you know, there starts to be opposition, resistant, we engage in healthy struggle, like we can't do this without struggle, but it is about always like being clear again around our values and our purpose. Those are non-negotiables. How we show up might look different. We'll get irritated with each other. We'll be upset, right? We'll party. We'll do all that. But the values stay the same and they're non-negotiables for us. And so that then allows for a lot of creativity, right? It allows for a lot of ways to be. It allows for there to be pain and frustration with each other, but still a commitment to come back to the table.
Thank you.
Well, part of me wants to just tell you that that's always been part of where I'm at. I didn't know the language of it. That's what I had to learn. I didn't know that, I didn't know resilience before I got to a public health school, and that's something that people were talking about. And then when I heard people talking about individual resilience, I kind of thought to myself, well, that's crap, that because it wasn't the people that were the problem. It was the systems that I had grown up in and experienced that were the problem. But I think it's gotten more accentuated in the past few years, and certainly with the time that I've lived in the state of North Carolina, as I speak with different immigrant populations, and I see their resilience every day, and yet they're kept down. I see the oppression. So the resilience telling us to be more resilient does absolutely nothing. You've got to stop the oppression. Yes. You've got to change the systems. And it was just so obvious, I guess, in all the conversations I have with immigrants and their families and people of color around the state over the years.
Becoming a father. becoming a father is what made me think differently about how I did what I did. Having a son and two daughters, because it became real for me in a way that, you know, it was my heart. And so my metrics for success changed. And so I thought differently about how I was going to use my time and efforts professionally. That's when it happened for me.
Thank you.
Thank you. And so now we're going to go to Brooke so we can get a question online.
We have another email question. This is from Alex, who is a social worker in the child welfare world, who is tired of seeing therapy being thrown at children as if it's the only possible response when trauma has occurred. She asks, can you please speak to the idea of culture as healing? How do we push more towards community engagement and creativity instead of evidence-based practices, one-on-one approaches, and interventions?
Yes. Yes. Let's do it. In some of the information I shared with the slides, in the campaign where we talked to about 500 young people, when we asked also kind of where they're going for supports, 1% of those who filled out the paper survey put counseling or therapists. And then in the conversations about that, though, what we heard was we need mental health support, but we need it in a way that is actually not judgmental, not stigmatizing, that actually affirms who we are and our histories and doesn't pathologize us for being Black, brown, undocumented, queer, poor, from Richmond, because that is the narrative that we get. And so what that means is healing happens in our music studio. Healing happens in our computer lab. Healing happens in the garden. Healing happens throughout RYSE. Well, we do have clinicians, right? Because there's still the need for that. It's understanding, like, it is on all of us to create those kind of gentle, loving spaces. And that healing doesn't get to be sliced and diced into clinical protocols. And again, so much money made off our pain. As an organization, we had to make a hard decision to actually stop getting funding through Medi-Cal streams, because it requires a diagnosis. When again, our distress is atmospheric. We don't need a diagnosis. We don't want the diagnosis, but that's what it takes to get those dollars drawn down. And it was actually getting in the way of the work. So, you know, but what we did the year and a half we didn't have that funding was we hustled to find those resources and engage in partnership, talk to folks who understood that the clinical model isn't actually relevant, is actually harmful, can be harmful for communities of color. But I also think, again, I just want to go back to this idea of the health equity sort of lens is that... just as with resilience, like I know it can feel good, right? It's not that blatant, sort of degrading language of something's wrong with you, but resilience is saying that. And health equity in that frame, if it's still about how can we make everyone good middle-class white people, that's going to be harmful. And that is how health equity is being talked about. And so not even good middle-class white people can meet those outcomes right now, but they don't get punished and stigmatized and criminalized the way other communities do. So I also want us to push on this idea of equity. And that's, again, why as an organization, it's about liberation. And we know that that has limitations as a 501c3, but it has way more hope for legacy and freedom than a 501c3.
I have two thoughts about that. One, evidence-based is what works. You might not find it in a journal or got trained in your practicum around what works. I believe in practice-based evidence as well as evidence-based practice. And so one of my friends has this saying, he goes, are you in the village that raises a child? Not it takes a village, but are you in the village and are you an active participant in that? And so I think we figure out to this idea of culture what it looks like. And we can only know by understanding the community, the young person that we're working with. And so sometimes what that child needs is a peer-based activity. So they don't need to sit on my couch. They need to go play soccer. Mm-hmm. Or they need somebody who will take them to the gym. Or they need somebody, you know, who will introduce them to something that they've not been introduced to before. I think what creates healing is what creates healing. And I think the only way that we can know that is by being willing to suspend what we think we know to figure out what we don't.
Yeah. So trauma is isolating. Discrimination is isolating. And for me, it's all about creating belonging and creating communities of belonging and all the strategies that you've just heard in terms of, you know, soccer teams and art and gardening together in communities that are accepting of various identities and cultures where you feel that you can belong. Those are what's healing.
All right, we are now going to take a question from our in-house audience.
So my name is Santi Bejarano, and I'm currently applying to medical school. And so as a person of color applying to graduate education, specifically medical school, I felt like the personal components of the application are asking for a recounting of my childhood adversities and challenges, things I've overcome, and they seem to place me in a sort of suffering Olympics with other applicants of color. So, and it's for a mostly white and wealthy admissions audience. So Kanwarpal, you specifically spoke about incorporating lived experience and lived expertise, interacting with our formal training and education. And Dr. Reese, you spoke about it a little more implicitly and broadly, but how do we incorporate our lived experiences and expertise in this process of applying to graduate education without devaluing them for a mostly white audience?
Yeah. Mm. Come up here.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think about, one, I'm really glad you're applying, so thank you. We need more doctors with consciousness, for sure. And, you know, we're here in light of and despite. And that's, I think I might have even said that in my grad school application. But I think what you bring up is so important, because that Olympics, it's not only harmful, it actually still allows and protects white privilege, right? In a way, so then we are figuring it out with each other, who gets the gold, who gets the silver, when there's actually none of that. Mm-hmm. But I think even just saying that, like, I would love to see that in an application.
Absolutely.
Like, that right? So again, you're saying this actually isn't a useful question. This is not a useful question, but let me share what is, right? I also just want to say, because I didn't say this in my presentation, I think it's so important to name, and I was thinking of it particularly in your presentation, that, you know, we have to also name the sort of the incessant anti-blackness in public health and in the systems and adjacent systems and medicine. Like, we have to call that out. And I think for those of us who are people of color who are not black, we have a particular responsibility to understand, like, my sort of trajectory here, the success that my parents have within an economic model that's oppressive is based on what's the proximity to whiteness, right? About, again, being good middle-class white people. And so, we have to call that out, because as non-black POC, we benefit from that too. And so that, maybe you can write about that too. But I do want to name, like, I think that is something that is violence as well. And that when we talk about the oppression Olympics, I don't say this sort of lightly, but I do think we have to understand that the power and the palpability of anti-blackness at every level is something that we need to be brave and make sure we're naming. And I think that's really hard. And at the same time, we still have to hold white folks accountable. Like, we have to still name that. But I just know that that's something that, for me, my ability to not be compliant was so based in the fact that I was not black, right, as a child. Like, that, I know that now. Maybe I didn't know it then, but I understand it now, that I got away with shit in school because I had done enough to be the good girl, but also because I was not a black student.
Yeah. So the fact that you are aware enough to ask that question, makes me less worried about you.
I want you to be my doctor.
Right, right. And actually, so the systems are what the systems are. I might pay attention to those institutions that are asking you those kinds of questions about whether or not that's going, whether or not you're going to be trained the way that you need to be trained to be the kind of healthcare provider that you want to be. I would love for there to be an interview following that essay and for you to have that dialogue with somebody, because to me, it suggests brilliance that you're aware of this piece. Because as when you were saying it, I'm like, yeah, that's traumatizing. Mm-hmm. Here, tell me about your pain. I don't know you. Why am I, why am I gonna share that with you? And so I'm encouraged. Like that's exciting to me to hear that question for somebody who's gonna be in somebody's medical school in the fall. Thank you.
Yeah, and then when you think about just completing the application in and of itself is daunting, but now you're sitting with additional barriers to completion. Right? And that's not the same for everybody, carrying stories into these application processes. So be encouraged, everyone who's applying to these programs, and push through and answer in ways that you feel fulfills your spirit. So yeah, thanks for that.
Rebelling is nice, right? But like, I also got to play the game a bit, like if I want to be a doctor.
Right, right.
That's real.
Yeah, and that this is like, I've made a choice, right? I got a code switch 12, 14, 20, 50 times a day, right? So we have to do that. This is a choice, right? And so there's a lot of agency and power in that choice, and it's hard. And you're going to be frustrated. You're not going to know what to do at one time. You're going to want to say all the things you can't say. That's all going to happen. But I mean, this is a place of such privilege and necessity, and you're up for it.
Yeah. So I think you can be just as honest as you were here today in your application. I mean, the premise here is the only way that you are deserving as a person of color, as a minority, is if you suffered. Mm-hmm. And that's not right. That's not the premise for a white applicant, and it shouldn't be the premise for you. So say, this is how I suffered, and then say, but that's not what matters. What matters is what I can be, and what I can be is an excellent, exceptional doctor, and this is why I can be an excellent doctor. So just do it like you did right here with us.
Thank you.
Okay. We're now gonna go to Brooke to get another online question.
Okay, this question comes from Dina. She writes, she's a white social worker who struggles with wanting to help others from different cultures and color, but feeling often that she's part of the problem. So what are examples of ways white people have helped in concrete ways, and what would you want to see more of?
This is harder than doing the preparation for the presentation. But that's a great question. Some of you may remember a speech that Malcolm X gave in the 60s. And he was at Boston University, I believe, and a student raised her hands, a white student. She said, "What can I do to help?" He said, "Nothing." He talks about that comment later and says that he really regretted his response to her in that instance, because he realized he was talking to a human being. And of course she can help. The fact that she wanted to help said volumes. I mean, I think that you've really laid this out nicely in terms of the work that you do as a human being and how you understand yourself as a human being. I do think that there's more that connects us than separates us. But what will connect us is your ability to kind of deal with the totality of my humanity, and my ability to do that with you. And so, you know, part of it is like, what does she know about herself? Mm-hmm. And it's the same question whether we're talking about a white social worker or a black psychologist. You know, like, I go into communities that I have very little in common with now, because my circumstances are very different 30 years later. who am I willing to be? How am I willing to humble myself? Am I allowed, willing to let the people who I'm hoping to engage to educate me, for them to be the expert on their lived experience, and for me to be the student in seeking to understand that experience? I think that when we position ourselves like that, that we that people pick up on our sincerity and our genuineness and our ability to want to understand and thus to understand. I think that's a starting place.
I would like for white folks to think about and hold race and their racial identity and the implications and benefits of it at least as much as people of color have to do, right? So walking into this room, scoping out how many folks are in the room, right? Like, I don't know, do white folks do that? You know, as a woman doing that, as a queer person trying to suss out who's family, right? All of that, like, and I think, so if we're talking about race, white folks sort of, it has to be in all of their being, in all of your being, to really be able to. And that might mean I need to step out. It might need, I need to intervene my cousin because they're out of pocket. Like, all of those things. There's, if folks are familiar with Dr. Ken Hardy, anyone? Mm-hmm. Yeah. He talks about developing a thick skin, and I think that's part of it. So, like, how do you build sort of, again, that resiliency to keep talking about it? We need white folks to keep bringing it up. It can't just be us, right? And to say it out loud to each other, be uncomfortable, be awkward, mess up. It's okay if we get mad at you. Like, all of that, kind of develop that thick skin. And also don't compare whiteness to some other form of, like, well, I'm a woman, so blah, blah, blah. Right. And I'm not missing, I don't want to dismiss the importance of intersectionality here, multiple identities. But the minute we start talking about race, and this happens primarily with white women, I'm going to bring up being a woman, it automatically shifts the focus. And it's, again, it's about protecting whiteness. And so that, those are the kinds of things. So, you know, getting the thick skin is really important, and naming it and saying it in all the spaces and places that protect you.
And I think I have a couple of things that I would like white folks to do, but I'm gonna name one. And one of them in my line of work is think about how are you raising anti-racist white children, and take active efforts to do that. And think about what does it mean for my child to have a healthy racial identity. And I think even that semantically, the idea of white children having healthy racial identities isn't as thought of as it is for us as people of color thinking about our children. And so I think that needs to become part of the language, the stories, the talk that happens in white families' homes, to think about how am I raising anti-racist white children. All right. And on that note, we have another question in the audience.
This is a short one. I've already been up here. All right, so with the adverse childhood experiences, you said as each experience, the susceptibility of you getting a disease or having a heart attack or whatever is higher. Is that really on a scale of 1, 2, 3? Because I've had 3 of my friends shot, and that's just one PTSD, you know, situation. As for when I go to school or when I'm at home or, you know.
Yeah.
So would you say, I lost the question. I was just thinking. I was thinking. My bad, y'all. But what would you tell the person that's been to 7+? Because your scale only reached a 6+. So what would your advice be to the person that reached 7, 8, 35, 60? You know?
Well, I think we can start by saying, you know, this is population level data, that adverse childhood experiences are not destiny. I'm probably a 5 on those, and you'll have to guess which ones are missing. But it's not destiny. It's not your future, that you're not necessarily, you individually are not going to have those negative outcomes, because you're doing different things in your life that are gonna make a positive change in your life, and and you know, this is very population level data. So I hate it when people look at that and they think, oh, you know, this is the end for me. I'm on a scale to 7 or 8, or I'm off this chart. We have many, you know, children of refugees, many refugees who have had incredibly traumatic experiences and go on to lead very healthy, long lives. Japanese individuals who were interned in the 1940s and camps in the U.S. and one of those individuals that I was reading about recently, he died at 104. You know, he had major adverse experiences and he lived a very long and productive life.
I'm really trying to speak upon like the people, because I'm part of a small percentage. Like I'm from Fayetteville, North Carolina. I'm in UNC-Chapel, you know, like this doesn't happen. Like if I tell my homeboys at home right now what I'm doing, they'd be like, how'd you get there? You know? So I understand where you're coming from for my perspective, you know, but what would you tell the person that had good grades, didn't have enough money or the time to be able to go to school, and their ACEs are rising, not just stopping and, you know, steadily going up. I'm talking about day to day, like every day. Yeah. So, and back to the health thing, that will create stress, heart attacks, and that will send them back to the doctor to get the diluted medication. So I'm just confused on a lot of stuff, you know?
Yeah. Well, can I, I'm gonna offer something and so ACES, it's a population level study, right? I think, again, we're an organization. We leverage the data, use the science where it's useful, but don't deify it. Like, or it's not like God, right? Like, right, but it gets seen that way, right? And then, but what this was and what they don't say in the video, it was educated middle class, primarily white folks, right? So it was a big old data set of white people's pain.
And that's what I'm right? trying to, that's what yeah. I'm trying okay. to get the gist okay. of.
You know, like, yeah.
Yeah,
so,
exactly, because that's yeah. average.
So now that we've seen white people have pain, right. it's time to do something. Right. It's the public health epidemic, right? And this happens, we see it when Columbine happened, shootings in Florida happened,
everything.
Right? And I'm not dismissing the pain. The pain is real.
Right, yeah, of course.
But what I also know, I know our pain, right? And the pain I don't know, I hope that someone can trust me to share and that I will bear witness to that, right? So that's why ACES, in our definition and framework of trauma and healing, is part of it, right?
Right.
And I stick that in there because I need funders to see that. Right. I need the policymakers to see, hey, I know what an ACES is.
Right. And
you
I
know?
Feel like we need a, I don't know, because that makes me feel like
yeah.
that's not my scale.
It's not.
You know?
Because it's not.
Yeah,
you are absolutely
that's,
right.
That's what I'm trying to say.
It
like,
is not.
0 to 6.
It is not.
Yeah.
It is
I
not.
I done hit 0 to 6.
And
at
look
six.
It, we're 10, 20, 40, 50, and we're still here.
Exactly.
Right?
You're right. You're right. For sure. I'm done.
Thank you. No, thank you, though.
We're now going to go to Brooke for another online question.
Okay. This is actually a follow-up to this question that just happened. Excuse me. In your experiences, what do you think is missing from the adverse childhood experiences, toxic stress conversation? And how do we begin to address the upstream issues, such as those captured by examining adverse community environments?
So, so what's missing from the ACES study is who conducted the ACES study. Mm. Like if you had a conversation, these are smart, capable people. That's not what I'm challenging at all. But the question is, you know, to a point that I raised on my presentation, who wasn't in the room when those measures were created? To my man's question over here, I had six at six. And so, you know, who is it that you're talking about? And if you want to capture my experience or the experiences of the communities that I serve, this has to look different. And if, in fact, you want to understand it. So I think that's part of it. But I think also, and we do that too often, like, you know, a lot of measures, a lot of research is inapplicable to the experience of Black and brown people. And part of our job is to be able to raise that, like, you're describing this population. This is not applicable to my population. Just like when we evaluate people and we don't have good psychometric data that's based on our community, those things become important. And you know, and so that's the one piece that I think is this was conceptualized and then operationalized in a way that did not reflect the unique experiences of Black and brown communities in this country.
So the ACES study, I don't know if everyone knows the history of it, and I'm not a principal on the study. I just want to make sure that's clear. But we talk about it a lot, and that's I think how I even came to be able to be a part of this panel, because we've pushed a lot organizationally around ACES and how it's being used and thrown at us in community work. But, you know, it was Drs. Felitti and Onda did it because they noticed something in a weight management class at Kaiser they were running. And that was that, you know, within 6 to 9 months, like the participants, right, they met their goals, losing weight, right? And within the year, gained it back, sometimes even double. And so wanted to try to understand, well, what was that about, right? And how could they understand that experience? And we actually had Dr. Felitti come out to our community to talk about it. And we showed him the expanded pyramid. So he knew what he was getting into. What we heard over and over when they interviewed people was that it was actually that was the protective factor, the buffer from the sexual abuse, right? And so the thing that we're trying to reduce, right, trying to get rid of, and I think about all the public health dollars around obesity prevention, and I think how, again, how violent that is when it's actually about the trauma, right? And it's about protecting ourselves, that gets pathologized and seen as deficient. And again, compounded if we're Black, brown, poor, queer, undocumented, or don't fit into, you know, really rigid senses of identity. So I think it's important to understand that too. And then if we start to look at other kinds of studies, like there are similar histories around that. So that's the piece that, you know, for us as ACES, I didn't even remember what the question was anymore. But I just feel like it's so important to say that what it was about, it revealed sort of the extent of trauma and pain, and that, wow, actually something like weight was what is helping me survive. And why don't we affirm that? Why don't we honor that and acknowledge it versus putting all this money into, we really need kids. And then again, Black and brown and poor and queer folks, femme identified folks are actually pathologized more than anyone else for it. Yeah. That doesn't leave a lot of other people, if you know what I'm saying, so.
Yeah. We have just a few more minutes and we're gonna take another question from Brooke online.
Okay, so the next question comes from Facebook. And this was posed to Dr. Dhaliwal. We're going to make you one today. So the question is, why did resistance feel like freedom? And how do you know that the population you engage with are free with resistance?
Well, if I'm linking resistance to what's happening to my body and the pain in my body, and again, when I was 16, I wouldn't have used these words. I'm 44, so that I'm using these words. I like getting older. It's great, just so you know. I love it. And it was that. It was actually, I mean, I literally felt in my body a lot better. I mean, that's what I remember. And for our young people, they don't feel free. I mean, that's what we know. And RYSE is a small, powerful space where, because we ask them, are we living up to our values, the values that we've co-created as a community? So we ask them. And so we hear often that RYSE is sometimes not even my second home, it's my home.
And so for us, it's like we know we have a lot of work to do to be free, but we can't not enact freedom in the spaces of control and influence that we have to get free, right? I can't do all these things that confine me and confine young people to then get free. So it's, you know, it's iterative. It's back and forth. Some days we feel more joy than others, some moments, right? But it's about having that ability, like Black and brown kids in our community don't get to be children, right? So we have workforce development coming in saying we've got these programs for 15-year-olds. You can't even work, right? But that's sort of the mentality. How do we make you good capitalists, good producers, right? And so again, public health does that too as well. So for us, it's, I'm never going to say all our young people are free. I can't say that, right? But what I can say is I will commit to asking, to inquiring, to bearing witness, to apologizing when I need to. That is one thing when young people tell us a lot is like adults don't apologize to us, even when they're wrong. And so I've had to learn, how do I apologize for other adults? Like, we have to do that too. So that's the work, but you only know that if you're in relationship, right? And that's the piece. Like, you can't do this. And health equity is all about relationship if we're looking at it from a liberatory frame. There's no kinds of research or logic models or protocols that will get us there.
We're going to take one more in-house question. I just want to remind our audience members that our questions be quick and concise, and then we'll only be able to hear from one panelist, okay?
Well, I apologize in advance because this is really a comment more than a question. I want to thank all of you for your really powerful presentations today. They've been really, really fulfilling for me. And I just want to say I came through this school about 30 years ago. None of these conversations were going on. None of this language was even being used. I did public health for 15 years and had to walk away from it, from banging my head against a wall that wanted us to reduce health disparities when no one was saying anything about equity issues or racial issues or social and economic justice. And that was only about 20 years ago now. So even though things seem really bad right now, and trust me, I wake up every day and think, whoa, can it get any worse? But things are actually a lot better than they used to be, because all of y'all, all of you people of color are sitting in this room, and these folks are on this panel, these brilliant young people up here who are doing this great work, and we are having these conversations together, and white people like me can stand up and say, wow, I get it. I am an extremely privileged white woman, and I got to do something about this, because that's where the change begins. And the last comment I want to make is, along with the ACEs study, there is a resilience page that's on the other side. So you get to check if you had a supportive adult, if you had people in your life, if you had a reasonable school system, that there's a whole bunch of check marks you can use to balance out your ACEs score with your resilience score. And so that's how people can survive in this crazy world in which we live. Thanks for listening.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. We hope that you will continue this very productive discussion with your neighbors, coworkers, and colleagues, since at this time we need to draw the webcast to a close. Many thanks to our panelists, Kanwarpal Dhaliwal, LeRoy E. Reese, and Krista Perreira, for providing their expertise for today's discussion of leveraging resiliency in the context of toxic stress and adverse childhood experiences. Many thanks also to our participants around the country and here in Joan Heckler Gillings Auditorium at the UNC Gillings School of Global Public Health. Your attention, questions, and comments have made for a compelling session, one that we hope inspires renewed action, leadership, and advocacy to create greater equity for all. The recording from today's webcast will soon be available on our webpage. Please tell your friends and colleagues about it. And do join us on February 22nd for the 40th Annual Minority Health Conference and webcast presented by the Minority Student Caucus at the UNC Gillings School of Global Public Health. And next year in fall 2019 for the 25th National Health Equity Research webcast. We ask that each of you check your emails to complete a brief survey. We'd like to hear from you about today's program and ideas for future webcasts. We thank each of you for joining us today. For more information about the National Health Equity and Research Webcast, visit go.unc.edu/NHERW. And now, for those of you here in the auditorium, we invite you to join us next door for our webcast reception, for refreshments, and to mingle with today's panelists and planning committee. I'm Ronda Taylor Bullock. I wish you peace, liberation, hashtag I believe her, hashtag Black Lives Matter.
Thank you.